वेलकम यू ऑल बैक इन जियोलॉजिकल नॉलेज। वी आर डिस्कशिंग अबाउट द टर्मिनोलॉजीज रिलेटेड टू द फॉल्ट्स, एंड इन दिस सीरीज और इन दैट सीक्वेंस वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट थ्री वीडियोज। ओके, एंड दिस इज द नेक्स्ट वीडियो इन दैट सीरीज। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट अवर डिस्कशन एंड द रिमेनिंग बेसिक टर्मिनोलॉजीज, फंडामेंटल टर्म्स विच आर बींग यूज्ड। Okay, so let's start our today's discussion. And the first question is, he is. And in the previous video, we have discussed about the heave, the throw, the head, as well as the dip. If you have not watched that video, go into the playlist and you can watch the video. And it's very important to understand the basic terminologies. Only then you will be able to understand the numerical types question or the other level questions. Okay, the questions whose level is very high, so those questions can be understood or solved only if you know the basics of the any topic. Okay, so we come back to our question, that heave is, what is heave? Horizontal component of the dip separation, vertical component of dip separation, normal horizontal displacement measured, or the signifying separation between two beds. So we have discussed it in the previous video, that the heave is the horizontal component of dip separation, and same is given here. Heave is the horizontal component of the dip separation, and is important is to notice is the measured in the direction perpendicular to the strike to the fault of the vertical plane. Okay, what is important to remember is the dip separation measured in a direction perpendicular to the strike of the fault in a vertical plane. Okay, so that is heave, the horizontal component of dip separation. Dip separation means the option A is the right. What signifies the actual separation between two beds? Okay, throw, offset, heave, or the stratigraphic throw. So stratigraphic throw signifies actual separation between two beds with a known stratigraphical position in a sequence of rocks that are now brought into contact by faulting. Okay, so stratigraphic throw is very important because that is the medium, that is the tool to simplify actual separation between two beds with the known stratigraphic position. Because before faulting, the original position or the original stratigraphic position was known, and after the faulting, that position can be rearranged. Sequence of rocks that are now brought into contact by faulting. So that is very important to know the stratigraphic throw. Option D is the right answer. Next is, what is the term related to silicon sites and used to express the angular relationship? Rake, tweak, slicks, or the offset? So we all know that rake is a term related to silicon sites in the faulting system. It's used to express the angular relationship of silicon site or the some other line with the fault plane. Okay, so option A, that is rake, is the right answer. Pick the term which is not a crust material: gouge, back fault breccia, kaolin, or the myelonite. So we all know that gouge, fault breccia, or the myelonite, they are the crust material. But as far as kaolinite is concerned, that is not the crust material. What happens during this process or the crushing process? The rubbing and mutual shearing of the blocks due to faulting. When faulting takes place, the corresponding blocks, they rub against each other, the mutual shearing blocks during the faulting, especially in the brittle rocks. Okay, so often they often produce typical crust material from the involved block that are useful indicators of the faulting in the region. Okay, so the most common and important products of faulting, they are the gauge, fault breccia, as well as the myelonite. So they are very important terms to know, and there some other related facts are very important. We will discuss in detail in the another video or in the new video. Here our motto is to understand the basic terms, okay, just to make you aware with the basic terms. We are not going to very deep. Okay, so if we talk about this particular question, so the term kaolinite is not associated with the crust material. What is also called as microbrexia? Gauze, kaolinite, myelonite, or the shale? So we all are aware with that myelonite is the microbrexia. Okay, it's also called as microbrexia and is similar to fault brexia, but it contains very fine grain broken particle. Okay, so myelonite contains very fine grained broken particles, that is why it's known as microbrexia. If we talk about the fault brexia, that contains coarser material, coarser particles. Okay, so fine grain broken particles from the involved rocks that get thoroughly cemented as well as compacted meanwhile in the process. So that is the option B. Myelonite is known as the microbrexia. The finely pulverized clay-like powdered rock matter is known as gauze, myelonite, illite, or the fault brexia. So it's very important to understand what is gauze, what is fault brexia, or what is the myelonites. If we talk about this particular question, so the finely pulverized clay-like powdered rock material is known as gauze. Okay, actually we understand, let's discuss some these two three topics like fault brexia, gauze, okay, or the myelonites. Actually what happens during the process, that along some faults the rocks are found highly fractured. Okay, there may be a fault plane, and along that fault plane the rocks may be highly fractured or even crushed to angular fragments. And if we talk about those angular fragments embedded in a matrix of finely ground rock, they are known as fault brexia. So those angular fragments, we know about the brexia, they are the angular fragments which are embedded in the matrix of finely ground rocks, they are known as fault brexia. And the fragment size of fault brexia may range from microscopic to several centimeter in size. There may be some secondary minerals such as quartz, calcite, or the sometimes pyrite may fill these open spaces within the fault brexia. And when these dislocating forces are very severe, as it's frequently the case, the thrusting of rocks may be ground to fine powder like material, that is known as gauze. Okay, whenever the dislocating forces are very severe, as is frequently the case in the thrusting process, the rocks may ground to fine and very fine clay like or the powdery material, that is known as gauze. And if we talk about myelonites, so in the process the gauze is frequently polished and striated by the fault movement. So a microbrexia that fills fault in the wider zones of intense deformation is called myelonites. Okay, so a microbrexia that fills the fault in the wider zone of intense deformation, they are known as myelonites. So it's important to know these three terms, gauze, fault breccia, as well as myelonite. What are their sequences and what is the process and in which order they are being formed during the faulting process? So this particular question, if we talk about, so pulverized, finally pulverized clay like material, powdered material, that is known as gauze. Seventh one is, the evidence of silicon site is easily observed in old faults. So there is a statement given here and you have to tell whether it's true or false. The evidences of silicon site is easily observed in old faults. So before we talk about this statement, we must know about silicon site. So what are silicon sites? So silicon site, during the process or the movement of one block, one wall against another, that results in the polishing or the grooving of the fault surface. During the process of thrusting or the faulting, the movement of one wall against another, that result in the polishing, grooving of the fault surfaces. So these grooved and striations, they are known as silicon sites. And if you talk about their significance, so they are very significant, they are very useful in deciphering the direction of the latest movement of a fault surface. Okay, so they are very useful. So if we come back to our question, that the evidence of silicon site is easily observed in old faults. So whether it's true or false, you have to tell. So it's false. Okay, it's not true. Why? Because the evidence of silicon sites may be expected only on the recently faulted surfaces. Okay, जो recently faulted surfaces हैं, there can be the evidences of silicon sites. Because in the old faults, such an evidence is more likely to removed by the process, subsequent process of weathering. Okay, so weathering acts on the rock surfaces, so that can move or remove the evidences of the faulting. Identify the type of slip from the figure given below. Okay, in this figure you have to identify the type of slip, whether it's strike slip, dip slip, oblique slip, or the throw slip. So if you have studied in the BSc classes, you would have studied about the types of slips. So this one is dip slip. The displacement has essentially taken place along the dip of the fault. So that is why the figure represents the dip slip. And there are some other slips like strike slip. Again, strike slip means the slippage along the strike of the fault, oblique slip, and the throw slip. So if we talk about this question, so this is the dip slip, option B. And next one is another figure based question, that you have to identify the part labeled as A in the figure given below. In the figure, what does this part A signifies? Throw, silicon side, heave, or the offset. So that is silicon side. The part A is clearly bearing the evidence of frictional rubbing against each other suffered by them during the process of displacement due to faulting. So it's known as silicon sides. Next one is, gauze and faults breccia are both in finally powdered form. So a statement is given here, gauze and fault breccia are both in the finally powdered material form. True or false? So it's actually false, because we have discussed in the previous slide that gauze is the powdered or pulverized material, whereas fault breccia is not powdered. That's a finally grounded rock material, angular fragments of embedded in a matrix of finally grounded material, they are called as fault breccia. So gauze is the finally powdered form, but fault breccia is not. Faulted braxia is the crust angular fragmentary material produced during the faulting, especially when the rocks are brittle and hard. Okay, so the given statement that gauze and fault braxia are both in finely powdered form, that is false. Option B. So this was our discussion about the fault terminologies. We have discussed about three videos on that, and I think now it's okay over for the terminologies chapter. Now we will discuss in next video about the classification of faults or their divisions, that on what basis they have been classified. Okay, so that is a very interesting and very important video to follow. Okay, thank you.